Thank you very much, Courtney. Coming up on July 13th, the Winnipeg Fringe Festival will return, and Chuck McEwen joins me with a look forward to, well, what we can look forward to with a bit of anticipation, because this is kind of a different festival, and Fringe, that's what it's all about.
It is. You know, we have over 150 theater companies from around the world, and we don't select them by artistic means or selecting them based on the type of play they are. Artists are free to create whatever they want and put it on stage for the audience to decide whether it's great or not.
And it's one of those things where you shouldn't be looking too far into what you're going to go see. Just go see something.
That's right. Well, with 150 shows, there's something for everybody. So take a chance, go out. If it sounds fun, it probably is.
There you go. Well, we got some cool ideas. Let's talk tickets, though, because there's a special for people this year.
Well, our maximum ticket price is $10, but this year it'll be a special 2 for $10. We'll have a few shows available, spur of the moment, that you can get. That's a great deal.
And there's a whole bunch of Pass the Hat and free events as well.
You bet. At Old Market Square Park in the Exchange, we have noon to midnight entertainment, all for free. Pass the Hat, you know, put in a toonie, put in a $5 bill if you really are enjoyed.
Yeah, at the end of the show, decide how much you liked her and drop it in and say thank you.
Yeah, if you're paying $10 for an indoor show and you're just as amazed outside, it's worth $10. Why not?
And you often get better scenery as well. There's also kids stuff as well for the whole family.
We have something for everybody. We have free kids activities, discovery tent, storytelling tent, crafts tent. So come on down with everybody in the family.
Well, we look forward to, as we lead up the Fringe viewing, putting a few of those artists here on BT. And for more information, go to breakfasttelevision.ca on all the events. Let's head outside now, check on the weather conditions, and say good morning to Jenna Kahn.
Well, it'll be another summer of clowning around in Winnipeg's Exchange District as the 24th annual Winnipeg Fringe Theater Festival is set to begin. As you can see, this year has a circus theme. The festival officially kicked off today to announce that advance tickets are now on sale. It runs from July 13th to the 24th. 150 theater companies from all over the world will be in Winnipeg for the 12-day event. The festival fairground will again extend onto Albert and Arthur Streets, where you can enjoy tasty treats, vendor stalls, busker circles, and kids fringe. For more information and to buy tickets, go to winnipegfringe.com.
High-flying acrobats, some hilarious clowns, and daredevil acts. They're all under the big top today on Backstage. They're back, folks. The Winnipeg Fringe is coming this summer, July 13th to the 24th. For more information, you can go to the website winnipegfringe.com, but it's all about running away to the circus. It is the big top. We have Ringmaster Chuck making a grand entrance, and here he is right now with more on the 2011 Winnipeg Fringe Festival.
This year we're doing the Big Top Fringe, the greatest shows on earth, which is just amazing.
Juggling knives are pretty dangerous, but I do have all the practice that I need to be able to ensure that I'll be safe while I'm juggling my juggling machetes.
My show is called Mr. Crumple's Puppet Play, starring Stephen Eric McIntyre as Mr. Crumple, and it's a puppet show, sort of kids show. It's a kids show, but for adults. Kids aren't allowed.
Some of the highlights, we've got some amazing entertainment on the outdoor stage. We're bringing in some amazing jugglers, performers, musical acts, all free for the family, general audience, you name it. We've got it for them at the outdoor stage at Old Market Square.
We are Momentum Aerial and Acrobatic Troupe, and we are Manitoba's first and only aerial circus arts troupe. We focus on creating choreography using anything that gets us in the air. In this case, right now, I've got a fabric sling, but we also have hoops, trapeze, ropes, harness, you name it, anything that gets us off the ground. It's glorious. It is so much fun. It's like the best roller coaster ride.
Indoors, 25 venues, 150 companies, 4 continents, theater, drama, improv, musicals, you name it, we've got it here at the Fringe.
My show for the Fringe is called Daphna, An Introduction. I'm the director and co-writer of it. I wrote it with a novelist by the name of Carl McAllister, who's a great local talent. And the show is about a young photography enthusiast by the name of Daphna, who's from Winnipeg, and it takes place in 1994. She decides to tread out on her own, try to find a couple of people to meet and photograph and work with, find love, loss, all sorts of stuff along the way. And it's funny, it's sad, it's quirky, it plays into all sorts of great mid-90s stuff, the death of Kurt Cobain, the bad trends in fashion, all that great stuff. It's a lot of fun.
We're doing Spring Awakening, a children's tragedy, and it's about 1930s school. It's a German private school, and the kids in it are obviously really like smart kids, intelligent kids, and they're experiencing changes in their body, right? They're going through puberty and they're coming into their bodies and they're being sexually repressed by parents, teachers, and everything. And there's battles with suicide, homosexuality, rape, and just the discoveries that you make when you're going through puberty.
So the name of the show is Shades, and it's a contemporary dance show featuring works by acclaimed choreographers Stephanie Ballard and Gail Peterson-Hiley. It features three main dance artists, Kathleen Hiley, Arlo Baskin-Nabis, and Robin Thompson-Konski. And then we have three guest performers, which are the males, and James Thompson-Konski, Ardley Zozabrato, and Warren Cleland.
Noon Hour Extravaganza, Big Top Biz, as well as the Kids Fringe, free entertainment for the kiddies all day long, crafts, storytelling tents, discovery tents, you name it, we've got all kinds of activities from the little ones right to the adults.
We are Ken and Tim from the KenandTimChannel.com. We just like to express ourselves in many different ways, one of them being
cultural dance.
Cultural dance.
Cultural dance. Well, we do a whole bunch of different characters out on the outdoor stage. Clowns, children's performers, cowboys, acrobats.
Not like what not is like happening here and high in the air and these a little bit more subdued than that.
We have such a wide variety of entertainment every year. You can never know what's going to happen at the Fringe, and it'll appeal to anyone. No matter what you're interested in, you'll find it here at the Fringe under the Big Top.
Don't forget the Winnipeg Fringe Festival, July 13th to the 24th. For all the information, go to winnipegfringe.com or stay tuned to Shaw TV for ticket giveaways. And they are looking for volunteers, so go to the website, winnipegfringe.com, to sign up. And good luck. We'll see you at this year's Winnipeg Fringe Festival. It's been a stellar year for Winnipeg's own Hot Thespian Action. This comedy sketch troupe is up for the 2011 Canadian Comedy Awards for Best Sketch Troupe and have performed alongside with Canadian icons Kathy Jones and Andrea Martin. Plus, they're writing their own TV series pilot. What else can happen with these guys? Well, let's go into rehearsal and see what really makes them tick.
Matter?
Well, I just can't seem to find anything to wear, and to make things worse, my shape is pear. Oh. Nothing ever seems to want to fit these hips. I think I'll stay at home and eat some chips.
Well, Sarah, I'll tell you what you gotta do. You gotta take the focus off that big caboose. Try an A-line skirt or boot-cut jeans. That'll fit your body just like a dream.
Well, you really know how to make a girl look good.
Well, it's my job to make you feel like you should. Cause every girl needs a gay best friend to help them along the way. Every girl needs a gay best friend will never lead you astray.
It all started 5 years ago.
We all went to the U of W, the theater department, and the girls of the troupe, Jackie, Shannon, and I, took an advanced mime and improv class together.
It was taught by Rick Skeen, who's a great instructor here, and he taught the three girls a lot about comedy and, well, obviously, mime and improv.
And it sort of naturally became a sketch writing class. And then we found some boys, because you always need boys.
Try the A-line skirt with a pin-tuck shirt. And in no time, Vladdy, you'll start to flounce and flirt. So everybody shout okay.
Okay!
Cause every girl needs a friend that's gay.
A friend that's gay. A friend that's gay.
Being friends with these people, they welcomed me into the troupe pretty easily. So I think the reason why they asked me was because we all jive together pretty well, you know? We like to sort of riff off of each other's jokes, and I think that's sort of what brought me in.
We're simpler, and not in a stupid sense, but we don't use costumes, we don't, you know, wear $5 wigs and try to do too much. I think we really try to take our ideas and show them in the most straightforward way possible, just using our bodies, and, you know, sometimes we're playing inanimate objects or animals and stuff like that, but we don't need to do the wackadoo kind of stuff that a lot of sketch troupes do.
Having the element of the mime really backs us up because we figure things out physically as opposed to just writing things in, and we don't really use props and big sets or costumes. We have to figure it out all on our own with either the way that we write it or physically.
Our material is really based on a lot of personal experiences. Our teacher had once said, write things that annoy you. And it's true, you'll find that those things end up annoying a lot of people. We wrote a sketch called Torture about a professor of English who is being tortured by two valley girls. And the torture is that they are speaking in imperfect grammar and sentence structure. And whenever we perform this sketch and we have a couple of lines that people really identify with in the audience, you can tell that it bothers everybody when certain things are said, and the whole audience is just like, yes, I'm very much on your side, that we hate, what is it?
Irregardless.
We've had a lot of really good opportunities in the last couple of years. 3 years ago, we started performing at the Winnipeg Comedy Festival after the artistic director of the Comedy Festival saw us at the Fringe, and he invited us to be part of the Comedy Fest. We had a really good time and did well, got good response, and so the next year they gave us our own show at the Comedy Fest, and that went really well. It sold out, I think it was the first show to sell out of the whole Comedy Fest, oddly enough. So that was great. And then last year, this most recent year, we had our own show, and then they also asked us to be part of the televised gala, which was awesome because we were performing on national TV alongside like Andrea Martin and Sean Cullen and Kathy Jones, and it was insane, you know, just to be in a makeup chair next to these Canadian icons and thinking like, how are we sharing the stage with them? It was crazy.
I tell you, when those alligators get there first, it just makes me feel like such a scavenger.
Oh, I know what you mean.
No, don't let them make you feel like that. You are a predator, and don't let anyone tell you you are not.
Hey guys, what you talking about?
It's Gerald.
Guess I just missed the feeding frenzy, huh? I was just hanging out with my school, my mom and dad, my home school.
Yeah, that's great, Gerald. So anyway,
yeah, what were you saying?
Oh, wow, you guys really stripped that cow to the bone, huh? That was like 2 minutes or under. Probably under, because I'm a pretty fast swimmer and I came as quick as I could.
Sketch comedy is not improv. Sketch comedy is written. There's a script. It can run any time between 30 seconds, 10 seconds to 20 minutes, as opposed to a play that you would have, you know, an hour or a half hour or 2 hours to. This is just a little snippet that has one point to it, and you try to be as concise and truthful as possible and turn everything on its side.
It's hard for women to accept that they are funny. It's almost like that's the man's job, and which I think is bunk. But it's sort of, we haven't been given a chance, really, and I think it's just, there's a lot more women in the spotlight, like Tina Fey and Amy Poehler and Kristen Wiig and women like that are just sort of, it seems natural. Like, of course we're funny. Like, who questioned this in the first place? But they sort of paved the way to give permission for women to be funny, so we can now just be ourselves.
Hey, Betty.
Hey, Paul.
Well, what's the matter?
Well, I've got this wedding that I need to attend, but my ex is going to be there with his lady friend. I'm going to look stupid if I show up alone. I need a sharp-dressed man to show up at home.
Well, Betty, I'll put your fears to rest with a Calvin Klein suit and matching vest. You can check your reflection in my shiny shoes, and your ex's favorite girlfriend will be singing the blues.
You really know how to make a girl feel good.
Well, it's my job to make you feel like you should. Cause every girl needs a gay best friend to help them along the way.
I've always watched a lot of comedians when I grew up. I watched SCTV, I watched Kids in the Hall, Monty Python was one of my favorite things. So it seemed sort of like natural for me to go into sketch comedy, but I always knew I wanted to be in the comedy world.
It's always a challenge. You're always trying to be better because I think we hold ourselves to a really high standard. And so I do, you know, 3-4 versions of a sketch before we can actually get up and do it kind of thing. And that's challenging to me. And it's, you know, teamwork and trying to always be respectful of each other. But we're still having so much fun. Like, we just, you know, we're doubled over laughing half the time.
It's like a weird marriage with 5 people in it and no sex with any of them. Which is good.
Hey, Mindy.
Hey, Paul.
Oh, what's the matter?
Well, I'm going out tonight with my boyfriend, Steve, but between you and me, I'm a little naive. Oh. I don't think I'm quite ready to go all the way, but I don't know those tricks to make him stay.
Well, Mindy, it's really quite easy. You'll find there is just one thing on every guy's mind. The word starts with an H and ends with a D.
Uh-huh.
And in between, there is an A and an E.
Oh!
Every girl needs a gay best friend.
Hell hath no fury like a woman scorned. It's Hysteria today on Backstage.
Kill the therapist now, it's done, yeah! Kill the therapist, kill the therapist, kill the therapist. Kill the therapist, kill the therapist, kill the therapist, kill the therapist now, it's done, yeah! Kill the therapist, kill the therapist, kill the therapist. Bitches in disguise.
I imagine myself on the front page of every paper and magazine. They blow up my mugshot, enlarging each wrinkle and pore. Big blocky headlines and columnists saying that I deserve the electric chair. But I wouldn't worry, I say to the jury that hell hath no fury.
What happens when you have 4 of Winnipeg's most talented ladies and you put guns in their hands? Well, maybe we should ask the playwright herself, Sharon Baeser. fantastic cast you have for The Fringe, Dream Team, Hysteria. What is it all about, Sharon?
Well, this is a project I've been working on for about 4 years, and it was inspired by just getting together with a bunch of actresses, actually a couple of them that are in the show right now, and we got together and we wanted to write a musical comedy for 4 women that didn't have anything to do with bodily functions or menopause or, you know, a lot of the things that those big comedies for women over 40 tend to write about. So we landed on mental health issues. Everybody seemed to have, you know, a lot of experience with, you know, depression, or a couple of people had experience with schizophrenia, you know, in their lives, alcoholism, addiction. I mean, it doesn't sound like very good material for a musical comedy, but we've managed to, you know, create something that's sort of a dark comedy.
Yes. Yeah.
Kill the therapist, kill the therapist, kill the therapist, guns or knife, yeah! Kill the therapist, kill the therapist, kill the therapist, kill that king!
Kill that king!
And the therapist is a key player in the play.
Yes, he's a key player in the play, but you never see him. He's only spoken about. And it's a murder mystery.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. What was it like working with all of these women?
Well, they're fantastic. Yeah, it's just, I feel like I throw impossible scenes at them and they just take it and run with it. Yeah, and the composer, Joseph Aragon, we've worked together a few times before, and I just love him, because it's a real collaborative process, writing a musical, because I write the story, and then up to the climax, and say, okay, here, now you write the climax of the show in a song, and I need this to happen, and this to happen, and need to change locations, and kill someone, so there you go. And then he takes it and comes back with a song.
Aww. Yeah. Let's see, you've got the easy job then, don't you?
I have the hard job, let me tell you. And I think writing the book is hard because it's all the stuff, it's all the stuff that needs to tell the story. And then all the, you know, all the fun stuff comes up out in the songs. Oh. Yeah, so it's the building blocks that I'm doing. Yeah.
Well, never a dull moment with you, Sharon. And I know this is going to be a fantastic hit at the Fringe. It's all during the Fringe, Hysteria. For tickets, you can go to the website, winnipegstudiotheater.com. And now we will meet the ladies, Donna Fletcher, Jennifer Lyon, Jan Skeen, and who I'm missing, Debbie Maslowski.
Hi, I'm Janine, and I'm a housewife with a perfect life and perfect children and a perfect husband and a secret. And I like to have some five-finger retail therapy.
And does your husband have retail therapy?
No, he's a police officer, so I have to be very careful because I don't want to get discovered. And he can never learn my secret.
What is your secret?
Well, I've been in therapy, and let's just say it's more than therapy.
I'm Sam, and I play a lawyer in this show that is, well, other people say that I have control issues, but of course, I just think I'm, you know, I have, I'm a little bit superior when it comes to responsibility. That's what I think. But anyway, oh, you probably
the gun.
Yeah, well, I don't really go anywhere without my gun.
Why?
Because it makes me feel secure, if that's... I don't like the way this interview is going. I think perhaps that we could move on to someone else now.
Oh, I play Deborah, and I'm a housewife, and I have a few issues.
Like?
I like to clean. I like to clean, yes, I really like to clean.
Like to clean guns?
I don't know how that got there, actually. I just like to clean everything. Everything, everything. And I repeat things sometimes I do.
That's kind of a small gun.
It does the job. I'm Brenna. I've been having a relationship with my therapist for, a good 8 years now. And let's just say it's developed into something very intimate. Not that I need a therapist. I don't have any problems. I don't have any deep-seated issues at all. No.
What's in the flask?
Nothing. It's just juice. Really. My father and I had no issues at all, but my therapist and I did. And it's not really working out anymore. I'm going to have to do something about it.
First day. I just arrived at the internment camp when I realized it was tea time. I readied my combat table and prepared my emergency ration of tea and biscuits when I felt the unnerving presence of my captor over my shoulder. My old nemesis, Commander Atiz, the old flying Atiz. At first, I didn't recognize him because he wasn't flying, but when he let out his first needlessly long cackle. I knew it was him. He had come, he said, come to make sure that his old friend's stay was as pleasant as possible. Naturally, this put my mind at ease, but then I discovered it was another one of his mind games. By friend, he meant enemy, and by pleasant, he meant unpleasant. First, he came to take my teacup, and I didn't speak because I could drink tea from a tin if I had to. Then he took my peaked aviation hat, and I didn't speak because I could sit in the shade. And then, in the afternoon, whilst I was playing a game of cricket with the other officers, he said I would have to wear prisoner's garb. just like everybody else. And I didn't speak, because remembering my training, I curled up into a ball and hoped that he would go away. He stripped me down and dressed me up like a POW Barbie. I never saw that uniform again. I missed it dearly. I still have nightmares, nightmares of what he and his cursed cohorts may be doing with my beloved clothing. Lighting it on fire and holding it just out of reach like a schoolyard bully. Placing it over top of a puddle for a Fraulein to tread upon. Wrapping raw meat with it. Using it as a toy in some kinky German bratwurst fest. Putting it on. Impersonating English officers for their friends. Drawing a mustache on the picture I kept in the pocket of Queen Victoria and I, exchanging flirty glances.
You went to Queen Victoria's and didn't invite me.
You were too busy in the hospital having your ear sewn back on.
First I've heard of it.
Precisely my point. Sure, I was eventually issued a new uniform, but it never quite fit right.
The production's called For Tea and Country. The story kind of follows this retired pilot from the British Air Service who has a vendetta against an old nemesis to get his uniform back. So kind of in spite of him, everything works out as he goes on this adventure with his old friend.
It has taken me all my personal fortune to find my old adversary and find that uniform. With the help of our allies, I've tracked the bastard to a comfortable cottage somewhere on the outskirts of his godless homeland. Kipper, I propose we infiltrate said cottage and get my stuff back.
The thing is littered with laughter. I don't think there will go a whole minute without anyone laughing in the audience.
Help me.
No.
Yes.
No.
Yes.
Nope.
Yup.
Sort of. No.
Sort of. Yes.
No.
I'm pulling rank. Yes.
You're retired. No, I'm not putting my life on the line for you again. During the Kenyan War, you told the locals they could eat me while you supervised.
I'm putting your life on the line right now. Yes.
Then once they got the fire started, you ran away.
Had to be done, Kipper, for the good of the nation.
I only managed to get out by telling them I soiled the bowl. I'm not coming with you. Absolutely nowhere.
Absolutely. Yes, way.
Negative.
Positive.
No.
Yes.
I refuse.
You riff.
Yes. Now I have a lovely guy. And a dog of good breeding that's small and adorable, and I'm not giving it up for some stupid idiot in his stupid idiot hat and his stupid idiot uniform!
It would definitely be Monty Python inspired or esque.
The Great American Trailer Park Musical. It takes place in North Florida's most exclusive manufactured housing community, and that's Armadillo Acres. Basically, the story revolves around Norbert and Jeannie, and they're a married couple. They've been married a long time, and things aren't quite going the way they need to be. Norbert's a toll collector, spends a lot of time outside of the trailer, and Jeannie is an agoraphobic, so she spends a lot of time inside. Pippi, a runaway stripper, and she's running away from her ex-boyfriend Duke, comes to town, and Norbert and Pippi start up a relationship of sorts, and then kind of chaos ensues in the trailer park.
Husband? Why get your own husband when you can just steal everybody else's?
Oh, yes. I didn't exactly wrestle Norbert to the ground, Jeannie. The way I see it, he had a choice, and he would rather go two-stepping than 12-stepping.
You want to see crazy, Pippi? Step a little closer.
Oh, yeah. Hopefully it's something that's fun for everyone. It is a little bit crass, but it is warm-hearted in a vulgar comedy sort of way. And it's going to be a lot of fun for everybody. What initially attracted Nikki and I to it is just the sheer hilarity of it. A lot of stereotypical things, a lot of 80s pop culture references, that sort of thing. That's right up our alley.
Oh, I ain't afraid of crazy, Jeannie. I've been doing crazy my whole life, and I'm hardly going to be intimidated by a woman who can't so much as step out her front door when her man's been out with another woman painting the town red.
More like painting the town red neck.
Oh, my God.
is called Criminal Genius. It's by beloved Canadian playwright George F. Walker. And it's about two inept criminals and their sort of journeys through the criminal underworld and how they manage to totally bugger everything up.
Look, okay, we're willing to help. We're willing to do anything short of hurting someone, and so is my kid. We're good messengers. Give us a message to take somewhere.
We're excellent snitches too.
Yeah.
To say it's an abusive relationship would be a bit of an understatement. They have an interesting, they're an interesting pairing, those two. Kind of vaguely Three Stooges. There's a lot of hitting, is what I'm getting at. I hit him a lot. I hit him in a hilarious way, though. It's not like that dramatic hitting.
Give us a message, let us snitch on someone while we're there. Stuff like that we can do.
We're excellent with those things. We even have a way of doing a good snitch. We do it together. It's like an act or something. I pretend to say something about someone I shouldn't, and then my dad cuffs me really hard on the head.
Like that.
And then I begin to cry. Sorry, Dad. Sorry.
I've been in the Fringe a couple times before, and what's really great about the Fringe is it gives people like myself a chance to really sort of go out and do weird new stuff, you know? Like, I've written plays. I have a play that I wrote this year in the Fringe, you know, and that would never happen in the professional world. Gah. So, you know, yeah, it gives me, and, you know, Criminal Genius is a strange little play, probably not going to be the sort of thing you'd see at the MTC main stage, but it's still a fantastically funny play, one of the funniest ever written. So it's been a real fantastic experience. I love the Fringe.
And then I beg the guy, please, please don't tell so-and-so that Stevie said such-and-such, because so-and-so will be real ticked off. And then I cuff him again!
Oh, sorry, Dad! And that usually works.
That always works.
That's what I said.
You said usually.
Usually, always, what's the difference?
Tell him to shut up.
Shut up!
Stephen Harper saves the world. Yes, you heard me right. Stephen Harper saves the world. Makes perfect sense to me. It's like Phil Collins saves the world. You think that sounds stupid? You think that sounds wrong? Or Steven Seagal saves the world? Or Fergie? The royal one, where it makes good and thorough sense to me, because let's face it, this is a crappy ass world which does not deserve to be saved by somebody classy, by a Nelson Mandela or a Gandhi, and certainly not by the second coming of Christ.
The show is called Gem Rolls is Pissed Off, and people keep saying, why are you pissed off? And I wouldn't really like to give the plot away. Maybe I am pissed off, maybe I'm not pissed off. But along the way, there's 15 very different performance poetry pieces. So there's some brute comedy, that was my longest comedy monologue yet. I've actually got a piece in genuine iambic pentameter. I didn't even properly know what iambic pentameter was before I started. I've kind of got a Goya-esque, horrible love piece. And really, I solve an awful lot of people's personal problems by extensive study of my own stupidity. And I didn't actually realize this is what I was doing until halfway through my run in Montreal, when I'm trying to solve an awful lot of people's problems by thinking at great length with horrible, painful introspection about the nature of my own stupidity.
Now, this is a lousy world run by bastards, filled with people who let themselves get ripped off by tossers. And I do not deny they might deserve to be saved, but they certainly do not deserve to be saved by somebody top notch. No, they deserve to be saved by somebody unmistakably, no pissing aboutly, mediocre. Al Gore, too good. Nicolas Sarkozy, Dmitry Medvedev, David Cameron, maybe. But first, they'll have to do something good. Don't hold your breath. It might be a long
wait.
Is Stephen Harper really going to save the world?
Well, you have to see the show, but I think our chances of Stephen Harper saving the world are fairly limited, to be honest. But it's not a bad first line for a show. Stephen Harper saves the world. Everyone pays attention in Canada.
And on a completely different note...
Oh, hello. Hello, John.
Well, hi there.
Right. Hi. Well, yeah, I'm in another... I've actually written a play, and so John's directed the play, and we have a cast who are these two very handsome people here, and they're actually marooned somewhere in the middle of the prairies. And it's a romantic comedy.
It's a postmodern romantic comedy.
We try not to mention the word postmodern, actually, John. Postmodern's a bit of a turn-off, so we have invented the genre.
Well, no, I think people are really interested in postmodern. When do you see postmodernism in the Fringe? I think there's tons of intellectuals there buying their elephant ears and then going to Fringe shows and looking to be educated. Education, see?
Yeah, anyway, we've been trying to invent the genre of the pomo rom-com. Postmodern romantic comedy, because then it doesn't actually use the word postmodern in it, which kind of might put people off. But apparently, I've been out of the country for a while, so when I left it was this handsome play of 75 minutes, and when I've come back, it's 55 minutes of a love story in 12 genres. Exactly. When did the genres enter the picture?
Well,
I don't remember writing that bit.
In Canada, directors take more control than writers.
Really? Really?
So
that's not either. That's Hollywood.
Oh yeah, that's
isn't that Hollywood?
This is a Hollywood play.
It's not a Hollywood play.
My first real proper actual job that I got paid for in the legitimate sense with national insurance contributions and tax and everything was for the city council. My job for 2 hours a night, Monday to Friday, between the hours of 6 and 8 o'clock in the evening was to mop the floor. Occasionally, I'd be called upon to clean one of the tiny squares of reinforced glass that had been inserted at head height in the fire doors, allowing you to see who's approaching the other way, and thus prevent you from violently smashing the door into their face as you rush from the hypothetical blaze behind you. Ah, it's a fire! No, it's false alarm, it's just my hand. It's called curriculum vitae, as in CV, and it's basically a potted history of my resume, or a portion of my resume. Generally the portion which is awful, as in not enjoyable, which is most of it. So, especially all the early stuff, from like being a child and the first sort of stuff your parents ask you to do for pocket money, or the rewards of milkshakes, and on through to like my first real jobs and work experience, and also it's a little bit of a guide to how to write a resume for the general populace. But this was more detail-orientated work, and was therefore left to the more senior members of our team. Sandra was the supervisor. She'd been there the longest, 2 or 3 years or something, and there was another Sandra, not the supervisor, who had started shortly afterwards. And there was clearly a little tension between the two of them that went beyond the petty annoyance of having to share the same name. Sandra, the supervisor, feeling threatened by Sandra, not the supervisor, and Sandra, not the supervisor, feeling that Sandra, the supervisor's position of supervisor was rightfully hers. Sandra, the supervisor, was a skinny, weak, terminally anemic woman with blonde, frizzy hair and an impossible number of teeth crammed into the smallest of spaces. She'd always produce pictures of her three pre-adolescent boys, the most pallid, sickly youths imaginable, with allergies to everything not thoroughly processed or man-made. She was always missing work because she was poorly or one of them was poorly, or there's a risk of an illness occurring sometime between 6 and 8 o'clock in the evening on a weekday. I hope people get out of it that they, firstly, I hope they laugh, because it's a comedy, and they have so far in every other sort of festival I've been to. But I also hope they get this sense of camaraderie, because these days everyone else is looking for a job constantly. I mean, there's no job for life anymore, and so people are always in between jobs and constantly treading the streets, handing out a resume, having to ingratiate themselves to a boss when they're overqualified for something because of the economy and stuff. So hopefully people will just get that, they'll just relate to me and to the show.
Sound and Fury's Doc Faustus, a soulless Western. And it's a retelling of Christopher Marlowe's Faustus story, but done as a comedy and as a Western. because we like to mash things up.
Governor Adrian Pope's place. Looks like I found the right house after all.
Dr. John Faustus! To what do I owe the pleasure of this confabulation?
Well, Governor Adrian Pope, you're the most powerful man in the state, and I've come here to be your personal physician.
Oh, right now, that's a bit of an imposition.
Has someone already filled the position?
Well, the position of physician is currently in transition.
Well, then it is my mission to audition for the position of physician.
The position of physician?
Isn't that what I said?
No.
It is my mission to audition for the position of physician.
Oh, well, I'm flattered by your intuition and wanting to diagnose my condition, so I give you permission to make your submission in order for me to avoid the anxious mortician.
Nice.
Yeah.
Well, here's my diagnosis. Is handsome a disease?
Creepy. Actually, you know, I've got too much weighing on my mind right now to make a decision about that.
Well, Governor Pope, it is my professional opinion that having too much on the mind is unhealthy for the humors. And since this here is a comedy show, I think it's best that you allow those worries to spill forth by sticking your mental fingers down your mental throat and allowing that bilious stream to unburden your qualmish noodle.
You have a huge lexicon, Doctor.
It's because of my giant dictionary.
We are a vaudeville nouveau comedy trio, so it's sort of old-style comedy, but modernized. So think of the Marx Brothers, that kind of thing. So that early American stage humor where there's no fourth wall, and we talk to the audience, and we break character while still telling the story. And we're bawdier, a little naughtier than they were back then.
Well, you know, there are three things bothering me. First of all is the drought. And secondly, the vicious surprise attacks by the Shawkinaw Indians.
Okay.
And third, that capricious burr under my saddle, the vicious Billy the Kid.
Oh, well, Governor, what if I were able to attend to one of these irritants? Would that affect your ability to attend to one of my previous offers of engagement?
Well, it would certainly go a long way to impressing me, my unctuous compeer.
Well, Governor, which one of these irritants has given you the most consternation?
Absolutely Billy the Kid.
Not the Shawkinaw Indians?
No, they're mostly a joke.
Oh.
We all live in Hollywood, California! And we do. We spend most of our year traveling to other places. It's hard to make a living there doing theater only because every wannabe actor comes in and does showcases, and it tends to be a lot of bad theater in LA. So getting an audience there is a lot harder than it would be anywhere else because people are like, really? Theater? I'm busy that night. So we go everywhere else in the world where theater is appreciated.
No, it's Billy. He's been hiding out in the hills in a cave, and we just can't find him.
Well, worry no further, my papal politico. You sit tight while I summon a demon.
While you summon a demon? Well, hey, you rang.
Mel? Is that you?
Yes, yes. If I'm unavailable to show up in person, I will simply possess the body of the person standing next to you.
Oh, how theatrically convenient.
Mm-hmm.
Well, what happens if I summon you while I'm alone?
Well, you know that feeling when your bladder's so full that your teeth float?
Yes.
Yeah, it's like that, but with an erection as well.
Okay. Well, I need your help, okay? Now, if I'm able to help the governor out, he said he'll hire me, all right? So can you summon this vile Billy the Kid?
Oh, your wish is my cliche command. I'll have him here forthwith.
Oh, good.
Summon a demon?
No, I said, well, I summon a demon.
You just said it again.
While I summon demand.
Oh, I must have heard you wrong the first two times.
Yeah, demand that vile Billy the Kid. He should be here forthwith.
Oh, look, there he is now.
My play is called Big Shot. And Big Shot is a Vancouver story that takes place on the SkyTrain in Vancouver. And this shooting happens on the SkyTrain, where an officer mistakenly kills somebody in an accident. And the story doesn't reveal who did it, but there's six characters involved who all sort of represent different iconic points in the Vancouver community, who all sort of defend themselves in their guilt in the event. They're all somehow involved. And the whole story is told from the perspective of a 12-year-old boy who saw the killing happen and who pitches the killing to the audience as a movie.
Yaku, 7年前はケーキが大変よかった。私は my son.Kesuke to mize o shite imashita. Itsu mo kimatte. One man stands in the shop and runs the till. Mo hitori wa mizu no soto. The fruit o hiki ni gara hana o mite imasu. I mean, they are just the flowers.
The play is sort of about our desensitization to tragedy and to urban tragedy and to the media.
でも人々が話さえも盗んでいます。Two men come in. Jinzu jakto to shid wa shatsu o kiteta. Esso no futari wa ii wa mitare de ne. So. Itori ga kabi ni aru hana o tori. Mohitotsu. Mohitotsu. Hohoemi e gao de chota no watashi ni itanda yo. Kesuke ga naka ni haita. Go back outside, Kesuke. Kara kaite kureru ka to ita. Nande ya no? Nani o suru ki ya nen? You filthy Chinaman. Karera wa watashi o oshi taoshi. I can't do anything. Futari zuri no otokoro wa hana o utatsu nahikirakite Kesuke ga ki ita.
My company deals with new contemporary plays, and I guess it's my company, you know. I really believe in using physical theater to break down language barriers that, as Canadians, you know, we speak. We're not even just bilingual, we're sort of seven-lingual, and so the Japanese culture being sort of half of Vancouver, I thought it was important to represent that with this character, this 70-year-old Japanese character in the play. So I learned Japanese for the show.
Hey! You must feel so proud for pushing down a helpless old man! Hey! I'm not done with you! Oh. And now we are known as the shop where the little Japanese boy died.
Big Shot is kind of a thriller on stage, but the thing about it is the boy presents this play as a thriller, and it's very fast-paced, intense physical theater. It's got a lot of laughs, surprisingly. And then what sort of, and I won't give it away or anything, but the ending of the play sort of shocks you and realizes, you sort of realize you were just enjoying this horrible tragedy and you were kind of feeding off of it. And I hope people feel a little shocked and amazed by the speed and the tragedy of the show.
To 150 shows, we might as well talk about some of them.
Yeah. So tune into Backstage today on Shaw TV.
I don't think life works that way, Mom.
Of course it does, June. No man could resist a woman offering her own cookies.
What?
Husband? Why get your own husband when you can just steal everybody else's?
Wrestle Norbert to the ground, Jeannie. The way I see it, he had a choice, and he would rather go two-stepping than 12-stepping.
You want to see crazy, Pippi? Step a little closer. I'll show you crazy. Oh, yeah.
He catches lots of fish. He catches all the fish out of the ocean. No fish left. He goes to town again, talks to the banker again, gets an even bigger loan against all his collaterals, and buys himself a new luxury cruise ship, a small cruise ship, to take the American tourists with shaven armpits on trips on the empty waters.
You're retired! No, I'm not putting my life on the line for you again. During the Canyon War, you told the locals they could eat me while you supervised!
You're putting your life on the line right now, yes.
Then once they got the fire started, you ran away!
Had to be done, Kipper, for the good of the nation.
I only managed to get out by telling them I soiled the bowl. I'm not coming with you. Absolutely no way.
That is just a glimpse of this year's Fringe Festival. The theme is Big Top, some of the greatest shows on earth. And while we have the ringmaster himself, Jop Schmidt, CBC Radio, once again.
Hi, I've been promoted to ringmaster. I'm very excited. This is good
or
news.
Or playmaster.
Sure, we'll go with that. Yeah.
Well, you know what? This Fringe Festival has expanded and grown so much, Jop. What is the whole attraction?
You know, I think it's word of mouth builds every year. People come to the festival, they talk about it. Ticket sales go up by and large every year. And I think it really is just a factor of the idea that this is theater that we don't get to see in Winnipeg. any other time of year. We get, you know, 12 days of it in massive concentration every summer. But it's the kind of theater that you're just not going to see the rest of the year anywhere else. So I think people are really excited about that.
All right, well, we always bring you along for the ride. It's a crazy ride, your picks. But it starts right now, July 13th, and runs right through until July 24th. Your first pick is?
I'm going to go with something for the fans of the classics, or maybe people who aren't fans of the classics, a little play called Hamlet, which, you know, probably heard of. But this one is quite different. This is being done by a young local theater company who are doing it as a rock musical.
Oh, so let's take a look at Hamlet and find out what the whole story is with this production.
If thou dost marry, I'll give thee this plague for thy dowry. Be thou as chaste as ice, as pure as snow. Thou shalt not escape calumny. Get thee to a nunnery. Go, farewell. Or, if thou wilt needs marry, marry a fool, for wise men know well enough what monsters you make of them. To a nunnery, go, and quickly too, farewell.
Oh, heavenly powers, restore him.
I have heard of your paintings, too. Well enough. God has given you one face, and you make yourselves another. You jig, you amble, you lisp, you nickname God's characters, and make your wantonness your ignorance. Go to. Have no more aunt. It hath made me mad. I say, we will have no more marriages. Those that are married already, all but one, shall live. The rest shall keep as they are. To a nunnery, go.
What a noble mind is here o'erthrown.
We do stick closely to the story. A lot of what Shakespeare does is repeating the story, so we did cut a lot of it, but it's just the doubled story. So you get all the story, and you get some awesome music.
And you flew too high, reached too far, far away, and you breathe it in. Violets bloom, fragrance though I'm alone. Fragrance though I'm alone.
Love, his affections not that way tend. I have in quick determination thus set it down. He shall with speed to England. It shall be so. Madison, great ones, must not unwatched go.
That was a look at Hamlet. That's performing at venue number one. That's at the main stage. Why did you choose this one?
Well, it's really interesting. I mean, you know, Fringe is always a bit of a risk. Some of the shows you're going to see are great. Some of them will not be great. But this is one of those shows that I think is really pure Fringe. It's people taking, you know, the idea of Hamlet, but turning it on its head, doing something that's very ambitious with it, turning it into a musical. It's a young company. I think everyone in the cast is between the ages of 16 and 25. So, you know.
And all local.
And all local, right. So, I mean, it's a totally, well, except for the fact that, you know, a British guy wrote it originally.
Yeah.
It's an all-local production. It's young people getting involved in the Fringe, and like I said, doing something that's very ambitious, so I'm kind of curious to see how it works out.
Okay, so your next pick is a one-woman play.
Yeah, and again local. It's a play called Catching Shadows, and it's by a local actor and writer named Megan Anders. I saw her in a Fringe show last year called Bedbound, which she was absolutely amazing in, and that's one of the reasons I'm really excited to see this show. It's because I think she's a wonderful up-and-coming young actor.
Okay, so let's take a look at Catching Shadows, and let's just say it's a little disturbing.
My sister. She always tries to be like me. It makes me so mad. Her grubby little fingers grabbing at my hand like she wants to hold on to me forever. She's always sticky, and she smells like honey or jam or cheese whiz.
The play is called Catching Shadows. The character's name is Ava, and she's a girl who wakes up in an empty space, surrounded by shadows.
Today, she follows me everywhere. Copying everything I do, repeating everything I say. I open the fold-out couch. She mimics me. I start jumping on the fold-out bed. She copies. I start singing at the top of my lungs. She follows. I stop. She stops. I collapse on the fold-out bed. She follows. I jump off. Before she can follow, I hold her down, roll the fold-out couch around her, and sit on it.
These shadows, she finds out, are actually her memories. So she's running around trying to catch shadows, catching shadows. And so this is actually a memory that she is having of what actually happened. So I don't want to tell you the result of it, because you got to come see the show.
I press my fingers to my ears against her muffled screams. Suddenly it's quiet. I slowly unroll the couch, and there she is. She looks like a doll, her eyes closed. She's not moving. I lean in close. Are you alive? The silence presses against my eardrum. I lean in closer. I'm inches above her face. Are you dead? My heart starts beating fast, too fast. My lungs stop breathing, waiting. I've been a stage manager, I've been an actor, I've been a playwright, I've been a site super. So there's just this magical feeling that you have, like you just walk in to Old Market Square and there's just, everybody is just friendly, and there's the stage, and there's the music, and all of the staff is so wonderful, and it's just something that I can't miss out on, you know. Like the Fringe comes to town, I'm here. I don't take vacation during the Fringe. My vacation is the Fringe. So,
Catching Shadows will be performed at venue number 2, and that is the little performance up the alley in between MTC and the warehouse.
Yep, MTC up the alley. So you kind of go in the back door of MTC and up some stairs, and suddenly there's a theater.
I know. This is all craziness, really, folks. The Fringe is everywhere. What I really like about Megan is that she's done it all, though, Joff. I mean, stagehand, stage manager, actress, playwright, director, and she's really come full circle.
Yep, for a young actor, especially a young theater artist, she's done a lot. And like I said, anyone who saw her in Bedbound last year knows she has the chops. Mm-hmm. She really is a remarkable young actor. So I'm looking forward to seeing this show.
Okay, and we're going to wrap things up with another female performance.
Yeah, this is by a female playwright. It's actually more than one person in this cast, which is exciting. You see a lot of one-person shows at the Fringe. So it's always thrilling to see more than one actor. It is a play called June's Window, which is by Eileen Longfield, and it's being presented by a local theater company called Theater Anywhere, who have done some really, yeah, really wonderful local theater at Fringes in the past.
Yes, so here's a look at June's Window.
Honey, that's wonderful. Has he lived there long?
I don't know.
Well, take a look. Are there pictures on his walls?
Nope.
Can you see any boxes?
One or two.
Perfect. Get in the kitchen and bake some cookies.
What?
I'd like to tell people that it is a story. It's a dark, dramatic comedy about a mother and daughter, mm-hmm, and a sexually intrusive neighbor.
Mm-hmm. Bake him some cookies and welcome him to the neighborhood. How else are you going to meet him, fall in love with him and have his children, and be able to say that you fell starstruck for the guy next door?
I don't think life works that way, Mom.
Of course it does, June. No man could resist a woman offering her own cookies.
It's based, unfortunately, on true events. And I think that is actually what's most interesting about it. It's sort of the type of thing that you would hear about on television or in the movies or in a play. But the fact that it happened right here in Winnipeg is something that I find truly astounding.
It's a surefire plan for at least some action, don't you think?
Did you just say action?
I may be your mother, but I have seen a James Bond movie or two.
My mother is recommending that I throw myself at my neighbor for...
Don't be such a prude, Juniper. Isn't that the way things are done these days?
Oh, no. God!
Is there a moral?
Close your blinds.
A lovely little Winnipeg story there, isn't it? But that's what I really like about Theatre Anywhere, the company that's doing this, is they have a really strong local focus. They're dedicated to promoting the theater scene locally. They're dedicated to doing local playwrights. They've revived some Fringe plays by local playwrights in the past. This one is brand new, so it's new work by a local playwright. So really got to give them credit for being big boosters for the local theater scene. So I'm looking forward to seeing June's Window.
All right, so you've got a busy 2 weeks. Joff, what is a magic website where you can go and see all the plays? He's going to be critiquing them, the whole shebang.
Yeah, me and the review crew, we will be putting our reviews up at cbc.ca/Winnipeg Fringe. It's easy to find. We're going to have reviews of everything up there by the end of the closing weekend, Sunday, July 17th. Everything will be on that website. So if you're looking for reviews on shows, that's the place to go.
All right, so we will see you here, though, same time next week. We'll be talking about all the international plays that are coming in out of town. So don't forget, it's the Winnipeg Fringe starting today, July 13th, and running right through to July 24th. And go to the magic website, and that's winnipegfringe.com. For Shaw TV, I'm Tracy Koga. All we're missing, Joff, is candy floss and...
Candy floss, maybe a cannon to shoot people out of. That's always fun. Could go with that. A net, ideally.
All right, okay. It is the big top. Winnipeg Fringe continues, and we have the ringmaster himself, Joff Schmidt, CBC Radio, with his top three picks coming up on Backstage.
What do you want? We'll give it to you. You want more? Just say the word. We'll find it somewhere. And everybody's totally okay with this. All my friends are posting Facebook status.
It is week two of the Fringe Festival, and how you doing, Joff?
Holding up so far, so good, I think. You know, yeah. Still standing, so I take that as a good sign, I guess.
Very good sign. Mm-hmm. Joff Schmidt, CBC Radio, covering all the Fringe plays. And I tell you, it was one super week, but this second week, we're going to be talking about the national and international companies that are coming into town.
Yeah, I mean, there's 150 shows at the festival. Half of them are local, but half of them do come in from out of town, and it is literally from around the world. You know, there are shows here from as far away as Australia, people from all over Canada, of course. So it really is an international festival, and that's one of the great things about it.
Okay, so we're going to head out to the East Coast. Dying Hard. You've seen this young lady, Michaela, before.
Yeah, I saw her show actually at the Ottawa Fringe Festival before she came into town here. Tough title and actually a very tough show. Like, it's very heavy drama, but absolutely worth seeing.
Okay, so we're gonna take you now to a little bit of Dying Hard and meet Michaela.
This is Kevin Kinsella.
And he said, you're not allowed in, you're drunk. And I said, well, I can't help that. I want to go in the club, I can't see any reason why I can't. So we argued and argued. After a while, I said, listen, there's only one way to settle this up. Come on outside, big man too, about 260. I never weighed more than 160 in my life. No trouble to handle him though. Yeah, he was awkward. Can't slew around that fast. Slimmer fellas got the quickness. It's only if the big guy hits you, you'll feel it then. Yeah, most of the time, though, you're going away with the blow. That's it, you're going away with it. About 140 of us, one time, we went down to St. Pierre to play soccer. So this boxer, he clears up three fellows off Drager from France. Pretty good sparring partners, too. I thought to myself, he's not getting away with that. At the last of it, though, they couldn't find nobody else to go up against him. I said to myself, I'm going to take him on. I was half drunk up. My sister goes, no, he'll kill you. He might kill me, I said, but not that easy. So I goes down to the manager, asks him if he wants a partner. Manager says yes. He asks me how many rounds I want. I said, I don't care if he fights for a week. I got lots of wind.
It's a verbatim theater piece, which means it's real people's true stories. So this particular show is about three mining communities in Newfoundland, St. Lawrence, Lorries, and Lawn. And they worked at the fluorspar mines of Salt Cove Brook and Iron Springs. And what I've done is I've taken interviews that were done by Elliot Layton, who's an anthropologist, and I've edited them down into six of those interviews. So there's six characters, and they tell stories about their lives. So they're really interesting people. One guy was a rum runner and a boxer, and he served in the Merchant Marines. There's another guy who got crushed working in the mines, but kept working for 20 years afterwards, and then only quit when his lungs gave out. And then there's two of the wives of the miners as well, and they're everyone in the show is super amazing and strong people, so I wanted to bring their stories.
Yeah, he settled on 15 rounds. Second round, they had to stop the fight. I came at him so fast, he never knew where I was coming from. He was boxing right-handed, I was boxing left and right. If I got him once with the left hand, I'd get him 50 times, like the piston of a hand. Yeah. Should have come in with left hand up, could have blocked it all. He didn't know any better, though. I know he was a good boxer. I saw him the next morning, whole face just as black as this, two eyes, cheekbones, everything. Yeah, he looks after the jail in St. Pierre ever since.
It's a real interesting play. It's so different than what you normally expect at the Fringe, and really interesting on how Mikayla put that whole play together.
Yeah, the fact that she went back to these interviews, it becomes sort of a docudrama sort of piece, which your eyes might glaze over when you hear the word docudrama, but she's such a good performer that she brings these characters to life absolutely and beautifully. There's a half dozen characters she plays, some of them miners, some of them the wives of miners, and she does all of them beautifully. So if you are looking for a more dramatic piece, meteor piece at the Fringe, Dying Hard is definitely recommended.
And there's of course a lot of craziness and kookiness in between, but now we're going to go to another guy, TJ Daw, and he's no stranger to the Fringe, and again, a very, very funny guy.
He is, and this is important because this is the first time TJ Daw has been back here to the Winnipeg Fringe himself since 2008. He is the man that is referred to as the Fringe God, just for the fact that he does remarkable shows and can sell out a show like nobody's business. So people will be excited to have him back in this show, Lucky Nine.
Yes, so here's a look at Lucky Nine, and let's find out what the big deal is about the Olympics.
When the Olympics came to Vancouver, it was a massive convergence of two things I've never been able to get into. Patriotism. I've never felt patriotic. I've never understood that impulse. I've never felt that automatic bond to millions of strangers. And spectator sports. I've never been into watching other people play a game. And I've tried, man. I've really tried. I've watched something like 200 sporting events of one kind or another in my life, most of them in person, either from sitting on the bench in basketball teams growing up, or going to watch other school teams, or watching minor league baseball games with my family, or major league football games, or watching hockey on TV, watching any kind of sports on TV. I couldn't get into it. I didn't really care who won. I could never feel like the team's victory was my victory and vice versa. I think it's the same problem as the whole patriotism thing. I don't automatically relate to a large group of strangers. So then, for me to live in the city of the Olympics, is a lot like as if your city was descended upon for two straight weeks by a massive conference of tax attorneys. Delegations of tax attorneys from every country on earth gathering to furiously debate a bunch of proposed tax laws that will be enacted decades from now in a country that doesn't exist. And yet, in spite of all this, everywhere you go, people can't stop talking about the tax attorneys. The tax attorneys. It's about how in the year 2009, three different things came into my life and changed my life. One is the HBO TV show The Wire, which is about social problems in Baltimore, which became a strong connection point between my father and I. My father's a retired Catholic school principal. How does he relate to the mean streets of Baltimore? I didn't know, but I found out. Another is the books of Gabor Mate, the Vancouver-based doctor who writes about stress and addiction and ADD and attachment parenting. And a friend got me into his books, and I got my sister and my mom into those books, and those facilitated a lot of conversations about ourselves that we'd never had before. And the third thing is the Enneagram, which is a personality type system that posits there being nine basic personalities in the human race. So I was very skeptical of this, you know, when a friend of mine introduced me to it, because I'm the kind of person that likes to believe they're unique, that they're individual. And what I found out was my type is called the individualist, that likes to believe that they're unique and individual. And this taught me a lot about myself. And similarly, I also introduced this to my mother and my sister, and this facilitated a lot of communication in our family in a way that had never happened before, and helped me learn a lot about myself and change as a person. People buy flags with names of the proposed tax laws on them and affix them to their vehicles. People buy tax law jerseys and proudly wear them down the sidewalk. Whenever they meet somebody else also wearing a tax law jersey, they high five. They maybe even hug. Whenever a tax law gets passed, people drive around for hours honking and honking and honking for the tax attorneys! The tax attorneys! Cashiers at the supermarket and tellers at the bank make chit-chat with you about how exciting the tax attorneys are. The media won't talk about anything else. Helicopters wake you up early every morning. They're watching everything. They're making sure everything is safe for the tax attorneys. The tax attorneys. Security for the tax attorneys conference. Just the security alone costs $1 billion. The overall tax attorneys conference costs $7 billion. The amount of that that's over budget? $6 billion. I grew up in a family that it wasn't constant hostility or anything like that, but there just wasn't open communication. The parents were the bosses. My sister and I didn't like each other, so there was no complicity between us. Growing up, we live in different cities. You know, we went to university in different cities. She has kids, I don't. I was always on the Fringe tour. She was always busy. We were never that close. We got close in the summer of 2009. And these things that I've been describing are part of how that happened. And meanwhile, there's homeless people who are fighting addiction and have nowhere to live. And funding is being cut for healthcare and for schools. Welfare is beginning slashed for more than a decade. The minimum wage is the lowest in the entire country. It's nowhere near enough to live on, and the cost of living in BC is the highest in the entire country. And the arts are about to be decimated by a 93% funding cut. But who cares? Let's give all our money to the tax attorneys. The tax attorneys, what do you want? We'll give it to you. You want more? Just say the word. We'll find it somewhere. And everybody's totally okay with this. This show especially it provides the audience with a lot of information, and the idea is to get them talking, whether they're talking to me or talking with their own family or talking with whoever they came with. Just it's introducing people to ideas that they can possibly find themselves in and begin conversations that could take them anywhere. All my friends are posting Facebook status updates about how exciting the tax attorneys are. The world comes to a screeching halt. Everybody's watching the tax attorneys. The tax attorneys. Ah! You have to love them. Ah! You have to be obsessed with them. Ah! There's something incredibly wrong with you if you talk about any subject other than the tax attorneys. The tax attorneys. Ah! Hey, we just passed a tax law. We did it. Our lawyers did it. We did it. We did it. We. Ah!
Wow, I don't know how happy Olympians will like to be referred to as tax attorneys, but TJ Dawes definitely does this.
He has a unique mind, the way that he sees the world. And if you've ever seen any of TJ Dawes' shows before, you know he's incredibly smart. He really does talk like that throughout his show. He's incredibly fast. So, you know, you really got to move to keep up with him, but it's absolutely worthwhile. I'm really excited to see him back, looking forward very much to seeing this show. And I think a lot of other people will be too. So if you want to see Lucky 9, get advance tickets.
Most definitely. And on a side note, it's always nice to hear that these plays really do make a difference, not only to the people that see them, but also to the actors. And I know that TJ went through a lot putting Lucky 9 together, finding out about his family and becoming closer with all his family members. So good thing.
Yeah, he's always been very autobiographical in his work, but this one I think really digs very deep personally. And I know before the festival he was saying to me that he thinks this is his best play, so we'll see.
Wow. So we're going to leave you now with a little bit of music. We're going to go into the world of Lenny Bro.
Yeah, a show here called The Last Gig of Lenny Bro. It's by Colin Godbout, who is a guitarist from BC. He's been here a couple times before with shows that tend to be music heavy. This is another one I saw in Ottawa, and your enjoyment of it will depend very much on how much you love Lenny Bro. If you really love Lenny Bro, you might like it. For me, I found there was not enough story here to really sustain it. I wanted to hear more about Lenny Bro, but there certainly is a lot of music.
Okay, so now we'll go into the world of Lenny Bro, according to Colin, and find out how Lenny Bro was such an inspiration to him.
The album that I grew up with was Live at Chili's Manhole, 1969 recording of Lenny Bro, and it was the first time I heard one guitarist that played so many styles, and he played them all his own way, and that really impressed me. And I've never really been attracted to being like a jazz guitarist, a blues guitarist, a classical guitarist, so I've come up with this phrase recently, global guitar, which I think, you know, Lenny was doing. They call me Lone Pine Junior. When I toured the country circuit with my folks, I'm back in the saddle again. Now Wes Montgomery tells his protege, George Benson, forget what I'm doing, there's this kid up in Canada. My mentor, Chet Atkins, goes around calling me the greatest guitar player, the greatest guitar player in the whole wide, the greatest guitar player in the whole wide world. If I'm not the greatest, I'm maybe the most famous, because everywhere I go, people say, hey, bro, what's happening, bro? I'm everybody's bro. But if I'm also Chet's great white hope of the guitar, well, that reputation requires inspiration, natural, chemical, wise, or otherwise. So I play these bell tones that I learned from listening to Chet's records. No, he'd play them as a two-note chord. I broke it down one note at a time. And I added grace notes with my left hand, because harmony is left and right, black and white. That's also why I keep this impressionist print in my guitar case. It inspires me, this gift from my buddy Raj's grandmother, my birthday last Sunday. It reminds me that I'm not really Chet's great white hope of the guitar. I mean,
He illustrated that concept with his record, The Day Fingerpickers Took Over the World. But I couldn't get into Chet's black and white world because I see myself like a painter. And by touching my strings in different ways, I add colors to my palette of sounds.
I see the world sort of similarly to Lenny Bro. And I mean, we're very different. I'm a lot more aggressive and I show up for my gigs. I don't take drugs. And I mean, he had some weaknesses, but his strengths, I mean, I'm not as talented as that phenomenal person.
Joff, I want you to share with the rest of us the first time that you experienced this show with Colin.
Yeah, I saw this show in Ottawa in the basement of a little pub. It was a very, very intimate venue. But when the lights came up at the end of the show, Colin stayed and chatted with guys in the audience for about 15 minutes after the show, just because there were a bunch of jazz geeks in the audience, basically. And they had all these questions about Lenny Bro, and he knew his stuff. I mean, you can hear in what he says that he's very passionate about Lenny Bro. He really cares about the subject material. He plays the music beautifully, but I would like to have seen more of that story in the show personally. But again, if you're a fan of the music, if all you want to hear is some music, he's a wonderful guitarist.
Yeah, well, thanks so much, Joff. I know that is just the surface of what you can see here.
Yeah, I mean, there's 3 out of 150 shows we've talked about. They have all been reviewed now, though, at the CBC Fringe website. It's cbc.ca/Winnipeg Fringe. There are reviews up there for all 150 shows, so before you head out Fringing, go check it out.
Congratulations to you and all your Fringer staff.
Team.
Yes, team. Whoa, that's the word. For more information, you can go to the website, and that's winnipegfringe.com. And we have tickets up for grabs, so call us right now at Shaw TV at 480-3500 or send us an email to shawtvwinnipeg@shaw.ca. Don't forget to leave your name and telephone number, and let's go with the code word, well, Fringe.
Seems like a good one.
Don't go away. We have hot thespian action coming up. They have to be one of the best and one of the hottest sketch troupes right here in town.
Funny kids, just up for a Canadian Comedy Award. Yeah, funny.
And that they have balls. A show at the Fringe, Best of Show. Don't go away, backstage continues.
Ce soir, des centaines de comédiens et comédiennes prennent d'assaut la capitale. C'est le festival Fringe qui commence. Pendant les 2 prochaines semaines, vous pourrez découvrir des pièces de théâtre, les unes les plus loufoques que les autres. On joint Sophie Frenagossa qui est actuellement dans le quartier de la Bourse à Winnipeg. Sophie, on peut dire que vous vous retrouvez là, dans le centre névralgique du festival.
Et oui, Patricia, il y a beaucoup d'activités ici, comme vous pouvez le voir. On y retrouve une scène de spectacle, des amuseurs publics, des kiosques d'art et d'artisanat et de nourriture, et surtout plus d'une dizaine des sites de présentation du Fringe. Les festivaliers sont déjà dans les théâtres. Les pièces ont commencé depuis 17h30. OK, j'entends juste rien, So.
Sophie, on semble avoir un petit problème, là, mais on va parler de théâtre, mais il y a également d'autres choses. Il y a de la musique country ce soir.
Et oui, Patricia, c'est ça. Il y a Kenny Chesney qui sera sur scène au centre MTS ce soir. Et un spectacle de jazz, pas comme les autres, a eu lieu aujourd'hui.
I'm trying to get used to that. Okay, here comes a zebra.
How about a nice round of applause for the G5?
Un orchestre ambulant s'est arrêté à l'école Victoria Albert au centre-ville de Winnipeg. Ce projet de jazz a pour but de rendre accessible la musique jazz à des jeunes qui n'auraient peut-être pas cette chance autrement. Les spectateurs en ont appris davantage sur les origines du jazz et sur les rythmes du blues. Et maintenant, je vous propose d'écouter mon reportage sur le festival Fringe qui commence aujourd'hui. Jusqu'au 24 juillet, ça va bouger au Old Market Square, de midi à minuit.
It's pretty good energy. There's a lot of people coming out and it's just a fun time.
Le 24e festival Fringe est à peine commencé et déjà, les Winnipegois s'y donnent à cœur joie.
We are the second largest Fringe festival in Canada and it's because Winnipeggers really like to have fun.
Les Winnipegois aiment s'amuser et ils soutiennent les arts et la culture, dit-il. Cela fait en sorte que le festival Fringe à Winnipeg est le deuxième plus populaire au Canada. Plus de 140 pièces seront présentées cette année par des troupes locales, nationales et internationales. Entre autres, une pièce intitulée « The Last Gig of Lenny Bro » qui met en scène un seul comédien de Vancouver. Elle raconte l'histoire du dernier spectacle du légendaire guitariste qui a habité Winnipeg.
Pour moi, c'est un grand honneur. Pour moi, jouer « Last Gig of Lenny Bro » ici, à Winnipeg.
Hey, wait a second! Diane, she's single. She hasn't made it for a few seasons.
Et une troupe manitobaine connue des amateurs du Fringe, Hot Thespian Action, présente une compilation de leurs meilleures scènes de pièces déjà jouées au festival.
On a commencé en 2006, c'était notre premier show au Fringe. Ça, c'est notre cinquième. Et c'est juste fun. Je pense que c'est le place parfait pour montrer notre style.
Avec des pièces comiques, dramatiques, musicales, d'improvisation et pour enfants, tout amateur de théâtre est sûr de trouver quelque chose à son goût. Et en terminant, le festival Folie Grenouille commence demain à Saint-Pierre-Joly. Des activités sont prévues dans l'arène du village à partir de 18h.
Merci beaucoup, Sophie.
Pas de quoi.
Le soleil aussi était de la partie. Par contre, demain, les amateurs de théâtre auront peut-être besoin de leur parapluie et surtout, ils auront besoin d'affronter la chaleur. Je vous en parle plus en détail au téléjournal. C'était chaud et humide aujourd'hui au centre-ville de Winnipeg. 36 degrés à l'ombre, ça prenait sa limonade pour se rafraîchir. Demain, encore plus chaud et surtout encore plus humide. Je vous en parle plus en détail au téléjournal.
Et la semaine dernière, je vous avais parlé du Festival Fringe, qui était toujours à la recherche de bénévoles avant le début du festival. Eh bien, on a répondu à l'appel. Tous les bénévoles nécessaires au bon déroulement du festival ont été trouvés. Le festival, qui bat actuellement son plein, compte chaque année sur l'appui de 800 bénévoles. Pour plusieurs, donner de leur temps est un véritable rituel annuel.
I love to volunteer and give back to the community, and I started with Fringe in 2000 and just found it to be such a fun time, and I have met such a lot of people that I see every year here, and it's just a great sense of community.
Et en terminant, malgré la chaleur, ce sera une superbe fin de semaine pour partir en région. Plusieurs villages sont en mode festival. Notons le festival Folie Grenouille à Saint-Pierre-Joly, le festival Châteauguay à Saint-Georges et la fête de la Bastille à Saint-Claude.
Merci beaucoup, Sophie.
Merci, bonne fin de semaine.
Au revoir.
Ici Sophie Frenet-Agosta. Parmi les 150 pièces du Festival Fringe, lesquelles sont les plus populaires? Vous le saurez sous peu.
Le Festival Fringe est sur le point d'annoncer les pièces de théâtre qui ont vendu le plus de billets. Elles étaient présentées dans une douzaine de sites et dans les plus populaires se trouvent également des pièces pour enfants. Sophie Frenet-Agosta a les détails.
Des chiffres records ont déjà été enregistrés pour la vente de billets au Fringe durant le premier week-end. Eh bien, les festivaliers auront de bonnes raisons de revenir en grand nombre cette fin de semaine qui vient.
My dear, I dream you.
Les pièces les plus populaires du Fringe seront annoncées ce soir sur les sites Facebook et Twitter du festival après 19h. Et les festivaliers pourront réserver leur place à partir de demain matin pour les spectacles convoités du dimanche.
lorsque les meilleures pièces sont jouées.
A lot of people have been standing in line for two or three shows already and haven't quite gotten their ticket because the shows sell out. A lot of the venues are quite small, 100 seats. So here, all of our tickets are available in advance for Best of Fest. So if you want to see that popular show, buy your ticket first thing Thursday morning.
Terminant, je vous rappelle que le Fringe Festival se poursuit jusqu'à demain, alors profitez-en. Également, si vous avez un cowboy ou une cowgirl.
Après la chaleur des derniers jours, une vague de fraîcheur s'abat en ce moment dans le Manitoba. On prévoit des températures bien en dessous des normales saisonnières pour au moins les 24 prochaines heures. Les détails au téléjournal.
Et maintenant, le festival Fringe qui se poursuit, se termine déjà dimanche. Ça donne évidemment l'occasion de rencontrer des artistes et de vous faire découvrir des pièces. Et cette fois, je vous parle de la pièce musicale Hedwig and the Angry Inch, avec comme personnage principal un transsexuel. C'est une pièce qui roule un peu partout depuis quelques années. Et là, c'est l'interprétation de la boîte Breathe, Feel and Love qu'on présente dans le cadre du festival. En somme, c'est l'histoire d'une vedette rock transsexuelle qui vit à Berlin-Est et qui va émigrer aux États-Unis et qui se marie à un soldat américain, tout un scénario. Et j'ai rencontré à ce sujet Cindy Douard, qui est une auteure-compositrice et qui joue la basse dans la pièce. On l'écoute. I've got a sweet tooth for licorice drops and jelly roll. C'est une pièce c'est quand même complexe. Le personnage, c'est une personne qui se sent incomplet, donc il passe à travers plein d'épreuves et d'obstacles depuis qu'il est tout jeune. Donc, il raconte son histoire. Donc c'est livré d'une façon monologue, mais c'est une pièce musicale très rock. Donc il y a beaucoup d'énergie, beaucoup d'émotions. Il y a plein de choses que le personnage dévoile à l'auditoire peu à peu, jusqu'au moment où tout explose. Donc c'est vraiment, il y a un peu de tout dans cette pièce. Il y a plusieurs choses taboues dans cette pièce et en général, il apporte à des places où les gens ont souvent peur d'aller. Mais c'est une pièce musicale, donc à la fin de la journée, même si on touche des sujets très tabous et puis des choses qui sont mentionnées, c'est quand même une pièce musicale. Donc il y a comme le soulagement du fait qu'on peut rire. Donc c'est pas des moments intenses où les gens ne savent pas comment réagir. Tu peux toujours rire, donc ça se passe très bien. La réponse est géniale. Chaque soir, les gens y adorent le show. Il y a plein d'énergie dans la salle. On n'a pas eu un mauvais show jusqu'à date. Donc, s'il nous reste deux shows, venez nous voir.
Ce qui est vrai, savoureux, dernière journée du Fringe Festival. Un premier bilan dans quelques instants.
Le festival Fringe tire à sa fin. C'est la dernière journée des 12 journées de festivités. Le théâtre était à l'honneur. On retrouve Gabriel Sabourin. On note de nouveaux records cette année.
Exactement, Melker. On connaîtra les chiffres finaux d'assistance demain. Mais déjà, on note des records pour les journées d'hier et avant-hier. Après avoir connu une certaine baisse durant les jours de canicule, mais le temps plus frais des derniers jours aura été bénéfique pour le festival. Et on pense battre les 86 700 quelques billets vendus l'an dernier.
La 24e année du Fringe Festival tire à sa fin. Des centaines de spectacles et d'activités. Le centre névralgique du festival, le Old Market Square, aura été envahi par des milliers de visiteurs, rendu possible par les quelques 800 bénévoles. Et aujourd'hui, cette scène se prépare à accueillir les dernières notes de musique, sous le regard critique de ses sympathiques spectateurs. Une dernière journée pour les festivaliers de voir les spectacles les plus populaires, dont la pièce de l'auteur Bruce Sorbitt, All or Nothing.
Je suis très honoré.
Sa pièce raconte l'histoire des derniers jours du philosophe Miguel de Unamuno durant la guerre civile espagnole.
He insulted him. The general wanted to kill him, but he was too popular.
Le général voulait le tuer, mais étant trop populaire, il le met en détention à domicile. Il meurt après 12 semaines. La pièce porte sur ses derniers questionnements. Une seconde carrière pour ce retraité qui a œuvré plus de 36 ans en psychologie. Sa pièce qui a été choisie de façon aléatoire, comme toute la programmation du festival. Et environ 90 % des spectacles n'ont jamais été présentés avant, du contenu original hétérogène.
Well, you know, with 150 plays from all over the world, it's really hard to pick one or two that just sort of stand out.
Avec plus de 150 pièces qui proviennent de différents pays, c'est difficile de déterminer les moments forts. Pour moi, ce qui ressort, c'est la diversité des festivaliers. Peu importe l'âge, la culture, la situation socio-économique, ils viennent en grand nombre, voire une variété de spectacles. Pour moi, le moment fort, c'est l'énergie qui règne au festival. Une énergie qui se renouvellera l'an prochain pour le 25e anniversaire de l'événement.
Cancer. This is cancer. I am cancer. I have looked down from on high and heard my name shouted in the streets. You run in my name. You collect money in my name. You sell t-shirts, magnets, cell phone accessories, iPod cases, M&Ms, and of course, batteries. Yes, of course, batteries. Look at that, Energizer. Energizer, look at that, eh? Of course, when I think of cancer, I also think Energizer batteries, eh? We keep going and going and going and going. Ah, darlings, you have no idea how wonderful it is to be the center of your attention, to be loved, nay, worshipped in so many ways. And it does not go unnoticed, darlings. Oh no, it's reciprocated. It's true. I love you. Some of you I love more than others. Some of you I love a bit too much. It's true. God, how can I resist, eh? You're amazing. I love you.
Welcome back to BT. One of the most talked about shows at the Winnipeg Fringe Festival is called This Is Cancer, and our star joins us, ladies and gentlemen, Cancer.
I
hope you don't mind if I don't shake your hand.
Well, that's quite all right. I get that a lot.
But I want to ask about why Cancer needs a show. I can understand why people want to see a show and face you and see you eye to eye. Why do you need to do a show? Is it a positive PR campaign kind of thing?
Well, what it is really is I've been hearing all these great things about me, you know, people raising money for me and running for me, and my name is everywhere. And
right.
I thought, look, obviously humanity is in love with me. Obviously they feel very strongly about me, and well, I just wanted to get up close and personal with my adoring public.
I think you may have misinterpreted the running for cancer, running against cancer. We participate in something called batting against breast cancer. Are you okay with people trying to, as they say, fight cancer?
Well, it's not really clear in the publicity that that's what that's all about. I mean, maybe I have been misinterpreting that, perhaps. But from my point of view, obviously, humanity is obsessed with me, and they obviously want me around, so I might as well, you know, just get up close and personal with
people. We do talk about you a considerable amount.
It's true, it's true. You put your focus on me, and I thought, why not just show up and let people see me face to face?
When people do see cancer face to face for the first time, what are the reactions like? Are you surprised by how they react?
Oh, people have been cheering, people have been applauding, they've been shouting. At the start of my show, I mean, they're all just chanting, "We want cancer." So, you know, it's great. Handshakes and smiles and things, wonderful.
Do survivors of cancer react differently to you than those who haven't experienced you?
Well, it's a bit more personal, I suppose. You know, it's like seeing an old friend.
Okay, one way to put it. Well, then if they are old friends, at the end of each show, you invite an audience member to come beat cancer.
Oh, yeah.
Why is that important to the show?
Well, because it happens a lot these days. You know, I'm not going to deny it. You know, certainly in the last few years, humanity has gotten a lot better at beating me. And I thought, well, I might as well incorporate that into the show as well, you know, let people have the opportunity maybe to work out some aggression. You are an aggressive species, after all. And I thought, in order to really let that kind of thing brew, we've got to, you know, let some of the energy out at the end of the show. And I think everyone feels a lot better.
In all fairness, we're both rather, as you've put it, aggressive.
Aggressive species,
aggressive.
Yes.
So let's talk about successes for you. Do you take particular note in latching onto celebrities, say like the Lance Armstrong battle with cancer?
Oh yeah, well I've got a black book, of course, of all the people I've taken and everyone I've ever loved too much, and I've actually got all the celebrities marked in there, and I take a certain amount of pride. You know, I'm not a collector, shall we say, but I'm certainly a fan.
Okay, do you have a favorite survivor that you've met during your journey? Because you've been how do we put this, touring across the world for a very long time now.
I have, yeah. Oh, no, there's been lots of people who've come up to me after the show. There was a woman, actually, in Calgary, Alberta, who came up to me after the show, and she said that if I had invited her up on stage to beat me, as it was, she said, no, you know what, I wouldn't have fought you. I wouldn't have come up there and fought you. In fact, I would have danced with you. Because for her, the battle with cancer or the struggle with me was not, it's not a fight, it's actually a dance. And she's been experiencing it in her and family for many years. And she says, you know what, this fighting and all that, that sort of aggression, that's what cancer does. But for me, it's about peace, is what she said. And she said, I would have danced with you, absolutely. And that to me is like, well, you know what, there's someone out there in the world who truly gets cancer.
This is your opportunity to get cancer, look cancer in the eye. There's still a couple of shows left. For all the information you want to check out, breakfasttelevision.ca. Gonna take a break. We have plenty more coming up on BT. Yesterday, sounds like it was a good way to launch things.
Yeah.
They call it the biggest shows on earth.
You know, I hear so much hype about our Fringe Festival and how amazing it is. It's running until the 24th. Yes, and as you mentioned, the 24th annual Winnipeg Fringe Theatre Festival. 25 venues, 150 plays. Imagine over the next 11 days. I wonder what the record is for one person going to see shows.
Challenge accepted.
How many shows can one single person see over 11 days? That's what I'd like to know.
Let us know.
Send
us your info. How many have been to? What was your record for last year? You're going to beat it this year.
Are you a hardcore fringer? Because there are.
Fringite? Fringehead?
Fringer's
good. Fringer's good. Coming up ahead. Coming up, John Kendall's going to join us. We'll talk a little bit about Fringe as well. He's got his three favorite picks because with all those shows, it's hard to know what to see, so he's got his three faves coming up. But now let's check on the weather conditions and say good morning to Kim Casher.
Fringes.
Good morning. Welcome back to Breakfast Television. John Kendall joining us with a look inside the latest edition of Uptown Magazine, and we're talking Fringe.
We are definitely talking Fringe. All Fringe, all the time. The next, I've lost count already, 10 days, I believe. The Fringe kicked off in earnest last night.
Yep.
6 o'clock on 24 different stages. There were plays going, there were fringers aplenty, and it seemed like it was a party. I saw some photos online last night. They've actually got an outdoor aerial circus called Zap Circus.
Cool.
That performs from a balloon suspended above the cube in Old Market Square for people. So, you know, if you're headed out during the weeknights looking for something to do that doesn't cost you an awful lot of money, this is all for free.
Yep.
At Old Market Square. In addition, as I said, there's 150 shows on at 25 different venues, and the most expensive ticket for a Fringe Festival show is only $10, so you can't get a better deal anywhere.
That is a huge deal, but one of the issues with Fringe is so big it's hard to know what to go see, so you've got your picks.
I do have my picks. The Fringe has 16 musicals this year. There are approximately 25 different comedy shows. I've gone for a little more interesting stuff, per se.
Okay.
Not the comedy's not interesting, but one called Spitting in the Face of the Devil. It's a very interesting story written by an American guy about discovering that his father, who was a decorated U.S. Army Marine, was a pedophile and how the writer came to terms with that. It won Best of Fringe in London, England.
Wow.
Last year, yeah. Then there's another guy named Randy Rutherford who's been coming to the Winnipeg Fringe for 10 years, and he's a fantastic storyteller. He's talking about his early life in the 1960s with his brother called My Brother Sang Like Roy Orbison. And the last one, Winnipeg Contemporary Dancers, in the Fringe for the first time. They're doing a show called Bash On Regardless, which is essentially a workshop presentation of a show called 97 Degrees of the Heart.
Neat yeah. Stuff. Very quickly, big concert coming in. Now, Big Top Fringe is promising 12 days of theater, some eye-popping attractions, and fun for the whole family.
And Breakfast Television's Sean Greck, of course, is taking in the Fringe Festival, and he takes a look at the circus downtown.
Just 2 days in and streets are already packed full of people enjoying their summer days at the 24th annual Winnipeg Theatre Festival, with this year's theme known as the Big Top Fringe.
Fringe has a wide variety of entertainment for everybody, and so we felt that really fell in with the whole circus theme, where under the Big Top tent you never know what you're going to see.
A circus indeed, as many were mesmerized, nervously watching the stunt-loving street performers fit through a tennis racket on stilts, juggle knives, or even chainsaws.
I'm just bringing a bunch of kids from the YMCA here because we thought they'd have a blast. And so we got to see this freak street performer who was pretty good.
But if watching a street performer possibly injuring themselves isn't a go for you, there's still plenty to do. Shopping, a petting zoo, live bands and acrobats, or grabbing a bite to eat.
The food on the Fringe grounds is excellent. Certainly looking forward to that. There's also a number of fine licensed venues I'm looking forward to. And of course the shows. Many plays that I'd love to see. I'm a bit of a poet, you know.
The Big Top Fringe will run until July 24th and will showcase 150 companies that have traveled far and wide to perform at the 25-venue three-ring circus. Street performer Skyler says it's a ton of fun, but most importantly, it's for the people.
Cirque du Soleil right now, to buy tickets, they're amazing, but the tickets are $80 to $300 for a single seat, depending on where you want to sit. And I mean, that's not accessible for everyone. So it's important for us, I feel, to come out and provide a nice little escape for people who don't necessarily have the money to go see live theater all the time.
They have performers that are come on stage and do family acts that are appropriate for the children. It's great.
First-time Fringe goer Mickey Daly was thrilled to assist one of the street performers and overall rates it as being
really fun.
The Fringe Festival is a guaranteed good time and you won't want to miss buskers like Chris without the hat. Chris, can you show me how to juggle quickly?
I would love to show you how to juggle.
Here, take this ball.
Take this knife. Take this chainsaw.
For Breakfast Television, I'm Sean Gregg.
I don't know what had happened.
You know, I haven't seen Sean since, actually.
Yeah. He either learns to juggle or doesn't.
Sean, he just dives right into it.
He really does. And like I said, I haven't seen him since. Don't know where he is.
All the best, buddy. Hope you're all right.
Now, Fringe Fest has some cool things going on with their website and with their Twitter account.
Yeah, I mean, there's so many different shows part of Fringe Fest. So Fringe has made it really easy for people to kind of stay on top of things and to get quick reviews just to see what kind of highlights they're going to want to get. They're all over Twitter, Facebook, and their website is really awesome, too. Here's their Twitter page. This is at twitter.com/WinnipegFringe. If you are tweeting about Fringe, you are suggested to use the hashtag WinnipegFringe, WPG. Okay. And they tweet about different events. They tweet random questions like, if you were marooned on an island, which actor from which play would you want to be marooned with? That was the question of the day yesterday. And they suggest people to tweet their reviews. So that's 140 characters or less. So that's very concise.
But think, sometimes reviews are very long to read, and this is concise, to the point. Yeah. I liked it.
That's right. I didn't like it. Simple as that.
If you need a little bit more space, there's Facebook. You can put your reviews on there. That's facebook.com/WinnipegFringe. And they've got links to both of these on their official website, which is really great to check out as well, WinnipegFringe.com. And you can actually win some prizes if you engage in their social media.
Oh, even better. Who doesn't like prizes?
Yeah, yeah, that's right.
It's good because the challenge with Fringe is there's so many shows. How do you decide what to go?
Well, yeah, that's exactly it. So if you didn't get a pen and paper in time to write down all those different addresses I just threw, you can go to breakfasttelevision.ca. I've got a compilation of all the different sites you can check out.
Great, good stuff.
Good.
Thank you, Megan.
You're welcome. Let's check on the...
Great weekend, everyone. We'll see you on Monday.
Take care. Bend down, isn't it a pity? Doesn't seem to be a shadow in the city. All around, people looking half dead, walking on the sidewalk harder than a match here. But tonight it's a different world. Go out and find a girl. Come on and dance all night. Despite the heat, it'll be alright. And babe, don't you know it's a pity the days can't be like the nights in the summer, in the city, in the summer, in the city. Cool town, meeting in the city, dressed so fine and looking so pretty. Cool cat, looking for a kitty, gonna look in every corner of the city. Till I'm wheezing like a bus stop, running up the stairs, gonna meet you on the rooftop. But tonight it's a different world. Go out and find a girl. Come on and dance all night. Despite the heat, it'll be all right. And babe.
And as one popular summer festival shifts into cleanup mode, the Fringe scrambles to make sure everything is good to go for opening day.
Winnipeg's summer of festivals is in full swing. Folk Fest is celebrating a record year of attendance, and final touches are now underway for Fringe Fest. As Global's Tamara Filanski reports, hundreds of volunteers are ready to go, but more are still needed.
After feeling the music, thousands are now feeling the Folk Fest effect.
Personally, I like to just throw everything in the garbage, just forget the whole 5 days of it happened.
because it was so fun.
Over the five-day festival, just over 81,000 people took in the 38th annual event. They not only set a record, but left behind a massive mess that will take weeks to clean up.
We're not done here till about the end of July. We have a site crew who's here about 3 weeks before the festival setting everything up, and it takes them about another 3 weeks after the festival to return everything back to its original condition.
As one signature summer festival wraps up, another one is waiting in the wings. Fringe Fest volunteers are putting in 16-hour days to make sure everything is good to go for the 150,000 Fringers set to descend on Old Market Square.
We've been doing this for a few years now, so we got it down to a science. We have 2 days to get it up and running before Wednesday's opening day at noon.
In all, a crew of 800 volunteers will spend 16,000 hours making sure the festival runs smoothly.
We have almost 1,200 indoor performances over the course of the 12 days by 150 companies from four continents. So it's a pretty big undertaking, but we can still use more people.
But it's not just volunteers racing the clock.
Chocolate mint, vanilla raspberry, some coconut ones.
Those at Cakeology are busy baking 5,000 cakeettes for hungry Fringers.
The first year was crazy. We had no idea what to expect. So the second year, at least we have some idea of what our numbers are in terms of how much food to make.
And with posters already popping up around the exchange, it seems the only people waiting for the fest to start Wednesday are the Fringers themselves. Tamara Frilansky, Global News.
Well, Winnipeg, here in Winnipeg especially, we have the Fringe Festival. Old Market Square is being transformed into Fringe Festival headquarters. They're setting up the old beer gardens there, and there's going to be a couple performances on the stage. Current temperature right now is 20. Different story for tomorrow. Looks like we'll see an overall clear.
Ready for some great performances, the greatest shows on earth, in fact.
Oh God, oh darling, you scared the life out of me.
Starting tomorrow, the 24th annual Fringe Festival moves in for 2 weeks. Winnipeggers can check out more than 1,200 shows put on by 150 companies. Old Market Square will be filled once again with buskers, vendors, and the Kids Fringe. Showtimes and venues are all listed on winnipegfringe.com.
The 24th annual Winnipeg Fringe Theatre Festival kicked off today. It's Canada's second largest Fringe Fest, with an eye on becoming even larger. Last year, almost 80,000 people went to the Fringe. This year, organizers want to see even more people taking in our great festival. There really is something there for everyone. 150 shows opening on 24 stages in and around Old Market Square. Lots of free stuff to take in too. There will be local performers, acts from all over the world, including Montreal, San Francisco, Australia, giant balloons, music, acrobats will be added to this year's circus theme. It's called the Big Top Fringe, after all. Its executive director, the director of the festival, reminds you there are lots of activities for kids.
We have a free Kids Fringe activities area with a storytelling tent, crafts tent, face painting, balloons, petting zoo. We've got something for everybody.
And CBC is the place to go for all things Fringe. We're reviewing all the plays at this year's festival to help you decide which shows you want to go see. Here's the CBC's Josh Schmidt with some of his early picks.
No, I don't know if you've seen these guys, but man, they're really funny. Hi there, I'm Joff Schmidt from the CBC Fringe Review Crew, here with some picks for your Fringe opening weekend. Now, I'm going to highlight three shows tonight that I haven't seen, but they're all local and they're all shows that I'm very much looking forward to. So keep an eye out for these ones. Starting with these guys, The Return of the Revenge of the Son of the Bride of Macabre Tales of Horror and Macabreness 2, Satan's Boogaloo. That's the full title of the show. So I'd say worth the price of admission for the title alone. Now, this is a sequel to a show that ran last year, kind of a horror comedy sketch show. Last year's show was hilarious. This year's promises more of the same. If you want to see it, they're at the MTC Warehouse, and they open Thursday night at 10 o'clock. Another pick for comedy fans is A Show of Hands from Hot Thespian Action, who've developed a reputation for being one of the city's best sketch comedy troupes, and this year they're doing a best of show.
Awake, women, we do this, just as poetry promised.
Check them out at Manitoba Theatre for Young People. Their first show is Friday at 12:45 in the afternoon. Get tickets early because these guys always sell out. And finally, a pick for dance fans. Winnipeg's Contemporary Dancers is doing a show at the Fringe this year called Bash On Regardless, which is a biographical dance piece about the bohemian Canadian writer Elizabeth Smart. They're at the Contemporary Dancers Studio in the Crocus Building. First show is Thursday at 8:45. Those are your Fringe picks for this weekend. Stay tuned, we'll have more. And always check out cbc.ca/Winnipeg Fringe for reviews.
Plus, it's day one of Fringe Festival.
Comedy, tragedy, improv, musicals, and then there's all the great outdoor things that you can do as well.
Why all the buzz may be online this year. From the We are going live now to Old Market Square, where Craig Larkins is standing by for day one of Fringe Festival.
Yeah, Shannon, the Exchange District has been transformed into, I'm calling it a mini Fringe Festival village. We have performers on the Cube all night long. It runs till around midnight. The last act takes the stage around 11 o'clock. We have the beer garden set up and, of course, food. My favorite part of any festival, we have samosas, freshly squeezed lemonade. They got the mini donuts and, of course, kettle corn and some burritos down at the end. And past all the food, right at the, near the end of Albert and Arthur, been completely shut down. They have been transformed into street vendors, and they got local designers showcasing all their clothing designs and little knickknacks and jewelry. We got some artwork, and also the Kids Fringe is actually down on Arthur, and they have a sand park set up on there, so you can bring on the kiddies. Runs all week long until next weekend, and of course, don't forget about the shows they're running throughout the city of Winnipeg at different venues. If you want more information, you can check them out by heading on over to winnipegfringe.com. You couldn't have asked for a better night for the Fringe Festival to kick off, and head on down here to the Exchange and enjoy some free concerts at the Old Market Square Cube stage. Let's talk about the weather right now. Beautiful day here, and the temperature sitting around that for the remainder of the night. So we have a beautiful couple days ahead of us. Things are really going to heat up this weekend. Shannon, I'll have all those sizzling details a little later in the show.
Okay, thanks, Craig. We'll see you soon. Well, love it or hate it, why not tweet about a review of a Fringe show you check out this year? As Global's Tamara Filansky shows us, organizers are encouraging theatergoers to tap into Twitter and Facebook to experience the festival in a new way.
The circus has rolled into Old Market Square, bringing with it the Big Top Fringe.
Comedy, tragedy, improv, musicals, and then there's all the great outdoor things that you can do as well.
It may or may not be the greatest show on earth, but North America's second largest Fringe Festival has a few social media tricks up its sleeve.
We were just putting out the word about our promotions.
From posting photos on the fly to rapid reviews of the 150 shows, the festival has launched 4 promos with prizes to help connect Fringers on Facebook and Twitter.
Review shows in 140 characters or less. So that way they can share what they thought just in a little brief clip and share their ideas with other Fringe goers.
This is the first year organizers are strongly pushing the online presence, and it's working.
I actually posted on Facebook asking people what I should see this weekend.
Organizers hope to get the hashtag WPGFringe trending across Canada, a feat within reach given it was a hot Twitter topic inside the city before the festival even started.
Just gets people talking about what's going on at the Fringe and lets other people know. And if you can't be down here, then you can be at your computer, maybe at work, if you're stuck inside. You know, you can just get into a little bit of the Fringe spirit.
Posters will always be a part of the Fringe, but theater companies are now turning to Facebook and Twitter in hopes of getting Fringers to pick their plays over others.
Like, I've been tweeting all through the rehearsal period trying to build up buzz, and once people come see the show, which opens tonight, hopefully there'll be a bit of buzz floating around with the WPG Fringe hashtag.
And you can follow the Twitter handle Winnipeg Fringe to get in on all the fun. Tamara Filansky, Global News.
And when we come back on the... We are going back to the Fringe Festival, where Craig Larkins is standing by and promising us, did you say a steamy weekend, Craig?
A sizzling.
Exact word, sizzling. Sizzling, I love the word sizzling. And scorching weekend ahead of us, Shannon. Today wasn't too bad either. We sat around where we should have this time of year, but again, it was a tad windy. But tonight, perfect conditions to head on down here to the Fringe Festival. Again, the free shows at Old Market Square in front of the Cube stage do go till 11 o'clock, so you got lots of time to head on down here and enjoy some free entertainment. Let's take a look at the future cast because we have a beautiful night here in the southeast, southwestern. Shannon, I just wanted to point out that you don't have to drive down here. They've set up a huge bike rack behind on the McGregor here. So if you want to save yourself some time and get some exercise, hop on the bike and head on down to the Fringe Festival. Again, we're going till 11 o'clock tonight. I'll be live at 10 and 11 as well. Shannon?
Okay, thanks, Craig. And of course, if people want to check out shows, head to winnipegfringe.com. Have fun. Thanks, Craig.
Yep.
The CTV Spotlight is next. The musical kickoff to the greatest shows on earth. This year's Fringe is now underway. Details next.
We're in the thick of festival season with another big one getting underway this afternoon. Winnipeg's Fringe Festival, now underway, kicked off at noon today with performances at Old Market Square. This year's theme is Big Top Fringe. More than 150 companies from all over the world will put on more than 1,200 performances. But those numbers, definitely variety and therefore something for everyone.
We've got our free Kids Fringe activities area, which has a craft tent, storytelling tent, discovery tent, face painting balloons, petting zoo, you name it, we've got it.
Tickets for the Fringe Festival are $5 to $10, or you can buy frequent Fringer passes, 10 plays for $79, or 14 shows for $109. The Fringe Festival runs until July 24th. More details can be found at winnipegfringe.com.
The circus has rolled into Old Market Square, bringing with it the Big Top Fringe. It may or may not be the greatest show on earth, but North America's second largest fringe festival has a few social media tricks up its sleeve. The festival has launched four promos to help connect fringers on Facebook and Twitter. People are encouraged to post show reviews and photos from around the event. If they do, they could win some free stuff, lots of stuff actually. This is the first year that organizers have tried this and they're strongly pushing the online presence. It's working.
So it just gets people talking about what's going on at the Fringe and lets other people know. And if you can't be down here, then you can be at your computer, maybe at work, if you're stuck inside. You know, you can just get into a little bit of the Fringe spirit.
The festival's hashtag, Winnipeg Fringe, was trending within Winnipeg before the festival even started. You can follow the Twitter handle, Winnipeg Fringe, to get in on all the fun. And speaking of getting in on all the fun, Craig Larkins is at Old Market Square joining us live for a first look at weather tonight.
Yeah, thanks, Heather. Tonight was the big kickoff to the 24th annual Fringe Festival. Right now on the stage, we've been seeing performers all night. This is the last act of the night. They'll run till around 11:30. We couldn't have asked for better weather. Again, 150 performers will take the stage and entertain you over the next week. If you want more information, you can check out the website winnipegfringe.com. And again, this is the 24th year, and on top of the performances down here at Old Market Square all week, they do have the food vendors, the beer garden, and Albert and Arthur actually closed for a couple days. They have a couple vendors set up and their local designers are showcasing their work. We got some clothes, we got jewelry, and they got some artwork down there as well. And again, it was a perfect night to be outdoors. That'll be the case over the next couple days. We are going to notice a bit more cloud cover though tomorrow. Let's take a look at the satellite radar. Nothing but clear skies here in downtown Winnipeg. Just some light clouds rolling through the southwestern corner of the province. Over the next 12 hours here in Winnipeg, our temperature will only drop to around 15 degrees. Will remain mainly clear for the overnight. Throughout the day though, too, tomorrow we'll start to notice an increase in clouds, and then we could see some rain roll into parts of the southwest, and later on in the day here in Winnipeg, I'll have all those details coming up in your full Skytracker forecast in just a few minutes. Heather?
That's great, Craig. It looks really full down there, which is wonderful news, and of course we'll check out back in with you in a little bit. Still ahead on News Final 3.
And Craig is back now with your full Sky Tracker forecast, doing his best to take in everything at the first night of Fringe tonight.
Yeah, you couldn't have asked for a better night, Heather. Things are getting nice and loud down here as well. The band is in full swing. They got people dancing in front of the stage again. Tonight is the kickoff to the 24th annual Winnipeg Fringe Festival. 150 performers will perform at venues right across the city throughout the next week. Now, let's talk about the weather. Again, clear skies here in downtown Winnipeg. Different story for tomorrow. Let's check out the temperatures. Now, daytime highs will sit where we should be sitting this time of year. We will start to notice, though, an increase in clouds by tomorrow afternoon. All those temperatures are bang on for this time of year. But again, we will start to notice an increase in clouds towards the lunch hour. Now, southwestern Manitoba could start the day with a few spotty showers, but temps will remain nice and warm, and all that cloud cover should start to clear out tomorrow afternoon. Further north we go. This is where things get a tad unsettled. Could see some showers moving through the upper half of the region. There's a chance of some thunderstorms popping up tomorrow afternoon in the Paw. Daytime highs will jump above the 20 mark. The Paw can expect a high of 24 degrees. Flin Flon could also see some of those T-storms roll through, while further north, the rest of the region will enjoy an overall sunny day. Conditions will continue to clear out throughout the day, so a very sunny Thursday for the Churchill area. Back here in Winnipeg, things are going to continue to heat up as we head towards the weekend. Friday, we're hitting around 30 degrees. We'll see mixed conditions for that day, mix of sun and cloud throughout the day. Once we hit Saturday and Sunday, check out those temperatures. We're hitting the 32 mark on both days. That's about 6 degrees above the normal for this time of year now. But there is a disturbance actually moving through northern Manitoba this weekend, and it looks like we could see some of that activity being pushed into southern Manitoba Saturday night. So we could see some thunderstorms develop here in southern Manitoba. They'll be short-lived and clear out by Sunday. Looks like we're back to sunshine and a high of 32, but overall, a hot, sizzling July weekend ahead of us. Get out there and enjoy it. Put on the hats, put on the sunscreen. That's your Sky Tracker forecast.
Sky Tracker weather is...
So, yeah, Heather, things are wrapping up here in about 5 to 10 minutes, around 11:30, actually. But if you want more information on performers, venues, where you can catch your favorite show, check out winnipegfringe.com. They got all the information there.
Okay, thanks, Craig. And lots of Winnipeggers showing off their moves tonight, which we like in Old Market Square. Hopefully he will join the party action soon.